Yeah, I'm Dominic, for the one who haven't met me yet, a customer success manager at LeanIX. Talked about GraphQL and talked about microservices before. This one will be a bit more use case based. So this one will be about integration architecture. And we invested quite some of our time this year into the data flow, into the visualizer to make it better. Because I will explain it a bit. We feel that providing ad hoc visualization of your landscape, let it be interfaces, let it be connections, is one crucial task for enterprise architects. And we definitely saw that there were some shortcomings in this direction. So this one will be about the data flow. Many things apply for the free draw as well. We'll focus a bit on integration architecture. So my goal would be what you'll learn. I have an overview prepared about the visualizer and how we see it in relation to the other reporting opportunities as well. Quick question on this, who of you did already work with the visualizer? Who did not but want to try? Okay, fantastic. So I will show this a bit, how we feel that this could augment it. Then we go into some examples. Because the way we see interface in Linux, the way we build our model is maybe not super intuitive at the first glance. So I'll bring some examples. So what are the premises behind it? Why did we do things like this? And then I go into the data flow to show you step by step how this could work. So you know we have the out-of-the-box reports. So the application landscape, you can filter, you can save your bookmarks and everything. So this is quite the normal one. We have the dashboards. And for those of you who do not know or do not have the option yet in their workspace, we are quite capable of adapting those dashboards as well. So bringing in other visualizations, not only the business criticality here, but for example, the functional fit for some domains only, maybe an apple a pie chart and not a bar chart. This is possible to design certain dashboards. If you have questions like why is it not available in my workspace, what do I have to do, feel free to approach me afterwards or my colleagues. We talked a lot about custom reports and the store. Yeah, so this is definitely one aspect we want to push to have out-of-the-box visualizations which looks appealing directly for your company. Yeah, so this is a store. You know you have a lot of interesting reports available just in your workspace, and you can add it to your workspace just once you get home. And today will be about the visualizer. So this is like the fourth cornerstone in reporting what we have. When to use what, and what is your radar, when should you do something? The out-of-the-box reports, they are standard. They are provided by us. And they have always live data, as you know. So if you click on an application landscape, you always see what's there in the inventory. Yeah? Disregarding whether you're filtered or not, it's always what's there. Same holds true for the custom reports, because they're using the GraphQL API, and the goal is that you see directly what's the inventory. For the visualizer, things are a bit different. And we see two major use cases. One is ad hoc visualization. We'll show and demo it a bit. So to say, you are in a meeting, you have a blank sheet in the visualizer, and within a couple of clicks, you can get exactly the picture that your stakeholder need in the meeting, and you can walk him through this picture. This is what we call ad hoc visualization. It's also on live data. This is standard functionality, but in the end, this is individual to your use case, because you can make whatever you want out of your data. The other use case we see with the visualizer is that you do integration architecture documentation. Who of you still use Visio in your company? Yeah, probably most who know still this DNA0 interface maps that everyone prints out knows that there's a case for this. Not sure how large the case is. We see people moving towards ad hoc visualization, but still there's a case of drawing maps of applications. And this is possible with, with the visualizer as well. Here, just important to understand, we have some options, I will show them afterwards, to update visualizer diagrams, but here the paradigm is you select what's in the visualizer. Yeah? You save a report and it's there. The data is updated in the inventory, but the report is not automatically because you have chosen to do this and you have some mechanism to update and sync the report. So it's just important to understand because the question in the data flow and in the FreeDAW then comes, is it automatically up to date and or not? Quick motivation. I mean, we talked a lot about growing complexity and everything. I don't have to repeat and go into this, but we see in a nutshell this use case of integration architecture becoming more and more important for everyone to understand not only the building blocks of your architecture, but the dependencies. We see many different ways to tackle this, but we see this as a topic for every company. And APIs in particular, I will include it here because as also pointed out by Andre yesterday, we want to look into modern IoT. So things like API management, maybe also open API to the other world, to the outside world. It's definitely something that we want to understand better as well. Maybe also to understand how can we integrate with API management tools. And this is just what Gartner views on APIs, how they can help. We share this to some extent. So we use APIs heavily in our internal development as well. Every team provides their stable APIs inside and outside to make sure they can interact. So coming to the interface fact sheet of LeanIX. Quick question on this one. Who of you has at least one interface fact sheet in the workspace? So that is a good idea to go through the interface fact sheet in detail. In a nutshell, those are the four relations that we have available on a standard interface. Yeah, obviously, you can configure the interface, but this is a standard model. So an interface is provided by one application. Come to this in a second. It's one application by design, and it's consumed by zero to n applications. It's one application because this is to us about ownership. I will show you the examples. For example, APIs, where this makes total sense. I know that this model does not hold totally true for legacy interfaces where an FTP is in the middle of something. There's some trade-off there, but this is a model we've chosen driven by modern interfaces, by APIs. And then I will also share some examples. It could be that you don't care who consumes it because it's an open API you provide to the outside world and you don't care or don't want to manage who consumes your interface. So it could be zero, but it could be an application as well who consumes. An interface is something we think from a business point of view, which is why interface is on the application and which is why it transports data objects. So it aligns quite well with this data management, GDPR use cases as well. And interface relies on technology, yeah? Whether it's an ESB or whether it's some FTP server or whatever. We see companies managing the technology they use for interface because this goes to the use case of technical standard management. From a technical perspective, do I want to have only REST interfaces? Do I want still ESBs? Do I want FTPs? This goes all in this direction of technical standard management, where reports like the IT component landscape and everything can help, which is why we decided to link interfaces to IT components there.
Is it
branch
on IT components?
Yeah. Yeah. So it's, no. Runs on technology. Sorry, good one. This is the IT component fact sheet. Yeah, so it runs on technology and this links directly to an IT component fact sheet. Yeah. Thanks for helping out here. I'll come to this example regarding middleware. Just to finalize this, we have certain attributes available on the interface in our standard. And one is particularly important. When we go into data flow visualization, we can define a data flow. So what you see here providing consuming is not the direction of the data, but data can be from here to here, or data can be bidirectional. So this is a property of the interface, and it's not connected to this providing and consuming. I know this is a bit challenging in the beginning, but this is once you understood that this is about ownership and data flow is then about how data is flowing, this will make sense. I'll go into some use case and some examples, and then we can have question round quickly on this before we go into the tool and have a look. So here you go. Let's use our own APIs as an example. So this would be the most standard and most intuitive example which we have. LinaX, so here you see also the legend. It's a four fact sheet of ours. LinaX is the providing application. And part of our software offering is a GraphQL API and an MTM multi-tenancy management API. Yeah. So if you want to have user information from us, you go to the MTM API. If you want to have fact sheet information from LinaX, you go to the GraphQL API. Yeah? So in your workspace, you could add a data object called user and a data object called fact sheet to understand which information are presented there. They rely on different technology. So the GraphQL API obviously is GraphQL, while the MTM API is a standard REST API. Yeah? And from a technical standard management perspective, you can then understand which REST APIs do I have, which GraphQL APIs do I have, do I want to do both, do I want to unify, whatever. So a standard Signavio integration uses the GraphQL API and a custom project portfolio management integration can use it as well because it needs fact sheet, while custom identity management might rely on our MTM API because it needs users. Yeah, again, we have the IT components as technology here. It's clear that the APIs belongs to LinaX as an application. So they are provided by us. And it might be a good idea even to go one step further and link definitions or even execution from the APIs here as well. So you can, for example, add your interface definition directly as a document as well. What we also see, and just a good side note here, even if this application is not managed by you, might be a good idea to put it in. So if there's some, I don't know, external department, external regulation you need to supply data to because of your business model, which is not your application, it still might be a good idea to put it as an application here, tag it with external, just that you can see the entire data flow here as well. Does this make sense so far? So the model extends to open APIs quite nicely as well, where you just say, okay, I don't care, or I don't want to manage who use my API. Yeah? So I would just leave out the consumer here as well. And this example shows another option or shows another use case. You could add multiple IT components. It might make total sense. You could add the technology, but also something like X-Ray, so an API management system to understand is an API managed by my standard API management system yet or not. Yeah. Those APIs, those open APIs, are not easily usable by the data flow, I will show in a second, but table view or inventory could filter quite easily for those without a consumer, or you can tag them by open API to identify. I will come to this last point, consider integrations afterwards in the wrap-up as well, because obviously data maintenance is a bit tedious. Middleware. This is one of the most frequent questions I actually get when talking about interface. What do I do with my ESP? What do I do with my SAP PI? Is it an application or is it an IT component? We see good arguments for putting it as an IT component, because what we learned from many of you is you want to see the data flow end to end. You want to understand from the ERP to the CRM system, is there flowing some product data or not? Yeah. If we put the PI as an application as well, we would lose this information. Yeah. Further, what I see, quick one.
Yeah. And then it created such a mess that it was not possible to use it.
Yeah. Yeah, this good one is the next argument that it will just have some central like a point in the middle and everything's there and everything's there, which is a bit a mess. The final argument I would give here is general modeling. Having a good definition of application is really crucial. It's a good practice to understand, make everyone understand what's an application. If I want to have a business capability added to SubPI or a user group added to SubPI, I will struggle because in the end it's something technical that runs my application. So in many constellations, this is the model we would prefer. We have customers who say no, the middleware is some application as well for good reason, but this is the 90% model we see. And finally, obviously we have like what Peter called it yesterday, shit of yesterday. We have all those things that we don't want to have. We have FTP servers, we have CSV, and we have manual interface in our company. And our advice would be to put it into the model, even if it doesn't fit directly. I mean, in the upper example, if you have an FTP server sitting somewhere, it's quite clear that there's no direct ownership, but it's sitting in the middle. But often it's a really good idea to say, okay, I have some rules to assign it to one side, not only to fit the model, but also to make sure to define responsibility. And the other thing, manual, we advise companies as well to put the manual interface that they see there. In Deutsch, in German, this is also Schreibtisch, Schnittstelle, means there's one colleague sitting this way and the other colleague sitting this way and putting some information. So it's a good idea to put this because it gives valuable information for consolidation and where it could automate. So those were the four like examples or constellations I would wanted to share. Did they make sense? Could you relate? Were you missing some of your use cases?
Like source system for the customer is Microsoft Dynamics CRM, but basically that data object is augmented with the data from HubSpot. And it's not complete, so we have two data sources and then we have a challenge how to model that.
Maybe we can look into this one afterwards as well.
Yeah.
I believe there are always some corner cases. It's interesting to look into the first 90% first and then move on. So let's walk through the tool. Yeah, so do step-by-step the data flow analysis. And we start with the different entry points. So there are a couple of ways you can enter the data flow. You can start with the interface circle map. So this is our high-level, fancy, shiny management report. What complexity do I have in my landscape? You can filter everything. You select one application, and then on top right, you have a button. And for those of you who don't know, this button will directly take you to the data flow, expanded for the application you selected. The idea is that you have your nice management presentation, and now you want to go into detail, and one click take you there, and then you can move on. Let's repeat it. Second opportunity is you can directly start with a blank sheet, so you can go to the data flow. You can create a new diagram by hitting the button, hit insert fact sheet on the top left, select your fact sheet, for example, by the quick search, just type HR admin, just hit insert selected, and use this little arrow there to expand things. Second opportunity to get started. Third opportunity to get started, same idea, but you can add multiple things at a time. This is something we added this year, makes your life easier. So you can say, give me all applications that carries employees. I do this, and now I just hit Control A, I select them all, click right, say show interfaces, and with a couple of clicks, I have for all of my applications with data objects, all interfaces on the canvas and can move on from there. So let's wait for this to repeat. Yeah, you insert all, you select all, and now you just say show interfaces. And actually we work quite heavily on performances here as well. So for something like 200, 250, 300 interfaces, this works rather fine, even if it takes a second or two. Yeah, so the fourth entry point would be by a bookmark. Yeah, so you say you did this wherever you came from, and now you can, if you enter the dialog, you can select the bookmarks that are already there. Top right, you can even save it, give it another name. In this case, it's Australia, and it shows all the interfaces by Australia. So let's move on. You entered from wherever, and you can then navigate through the interfaces. You can say, by the little arrow, you expand it. You either have the option to say, I want to show all the interfaces, or something that's new as well, you can right-click and say, show interfaces by filter. And then, for example, show only the interfaces relevant for one project or for one data object, or handpick them, that you only have three more interfaces there. Yeah. And the other thing is you can drill down. You can include more objects and applications here. So for example, data objects. But just hitting drill down and say you want to show data objects or IT components or other things as well. Yeah. Again, to show this quickly, this is the ad hoc mode I pointed out before. This is something you could do in your meeting with your stakeholders to say, hey, take a look at the landscape now. We walk step by step through this and have every application, every interface on the canvas that we need, and then we can move on from there. Yeah. Next step would be you can work with the layout. You see on top there are two buttons, it's labels and this horizontal button. And label, what you just saw is we selected the data object instead, and now you can adapt the layout either to vertical or even to manual. And manual let you just work with the boxes. Like you know in Visio, for example, you can increase the size of the boxes, you can work with the lines, you can even add manual elements as well, manual boxes to make it fancy and shiny to what you need. You can switch back to the vertical flow even to make it look better. And in the end, again, you can save it and say, okay, look, this is my report right now, which I can share. Yeah. You can color applications, even as of today. And we announced in the keynote yesterday that we will improve this. Like you know, in the application landscape, you can then take all the text to color things. But what you can do even today is you have a nice little functionality on top left, which is select by filter. You selected some of the application. And now you just paint them red, paint them green, directly interactively. Yeah. So select by filter would allow you to give a filter you want. So you can either handpick the application, you can say everything with the name SAP, everything with high business criticality, everything where I'm the owner. You're totally free to use all the filtering mechanisms that we have to paint things. And again, either save things or export to some image to work on with this one. Yeah. So even this is just there today and make your life easy. Again, might be a good point to point out that all this, not the expand of the interface, but everything else is also available in this free draw mode. Yeah. So in the free draw mode, when you just navigate through the inventory, not interface, but every relation, you have the same mechanism, like select by filter, show me all SAP or show me all critical applications or something. You can paint them, group them by this mechanism. Fifth is then about like what to do with the data. As I said, by default, it's not refreshing, but you can work with the data. So for example, I change the name of an application, so add a release there, and I change the life cycle of an interface. Yeah, so I go to the fact sheet, and now I just add a life cycle. So I say it's no longer in use. And now on top left, you see you have refresh and check for updates. I checked for updates, I see two updates, and I see right now that the interface is red and that employee appraisal went to version 0.2. Yeah, so this is not for all changes yet. This could for sure be improved. But those standard use cases like changing the lifecycle, changing data object, changing names of applications, or removing even interfaces, those are covered by this mechanism. You go to check for updates, you see that you have some update, and you refresh it. Yeah? For sure, something for the roadmap to make this even more convenient in many use cases, but as I said, this functionality is there as of today. And similar to new interfaces. So I go to HR admin as an application fact sheet. And I just say I add a new interface. It consumes another interface, which is already in the inventory, provided by another application. Save it. And if I go back to the report and right click and hit drill down again, you see that right now I can click on consumed interfaces again. Show interfaces after a refresh, and the new interface is also there. And now I can align it to my layout. Yeah. This gives you a quick preview of how things could work then in this lower mode. From what I mentioned in the beginning, if you want to create permanent visualization, you obviously have to refresh from time to time to check for new interfaces. This would be your standard workflows you would need to do to keep those interface drawings up to date, save or export. I mentioned it a couple of times, but it could not be re-emphasized here. I can save. So I did some work in the interface. And to those of you who don't know yet, I can do this for all reports and also for the filters in my table view. So this is really a good practice as well to make people use bookmarks, because in the end, it makes your life easier or the user's life easier. Even if it's only some filter or some clicks, make people use bookmarks. They can use a bookmark privately, meaning nobody else seeing it, or published it only, meaning everyone can see this, but nobody else can edit it. But this makes the life easier to access the data. And in the end, the Confluence integration is also relying on these bookmarks, just to close this loop here. So Confluence, you need a bookmark to say then, okay, this stored information is exported.
Shared means everybody
can edit it. Yeah, exactly. Okay. So shared would be true collaboration. Everyone can edit it. As you've seen, we have this autosave mode there on top right, meaning in this particular case of data flow or of redraw, we have a locking mechanism, meaning not two people can edit at a time. Might be a nice idea to do this later version as well, like you know, for example, from Google Drive, that you see somebody else editing in the diagram. This might be a good idea and fancy idea, which we discussed actually, but it's not there yet.
So for sharing, because I don't know for how about that for the customer, but for us, we need another additional function for sharing that you can share for specific member, because at the moment, even viewer, they can edit the diagram.
I'm totally with you. I mean, the bookmark handling, we had like grouping bookmarks and everything before. The bookmark handling definitely can be improved. So having more options there, also when you have large number of bookmarks, they are just listed here. It's definitely something where we can work on from UX perspective. So talk to Christian, talk to the UX guys to bring it into their awareness. This is definitely something which we need to do. This is interesting. I had so many different problems with those images these days, so now it's black and white? Okay, cool. So, takeaways from my side. I mean, we went into Q&A, we can discuss further as well. But takeaways from my side, what you should take home to your already fully packed brain. I would really encourage you to try out the visualizer. There's some learning curve. You have to get a bit into the mood how this works. But ad hoc visualization, using it in a meeting with other stakeholders can be so valuable, especially if you go there and directly edit things. So you talk to a stakeholder about your interfaces. You recognize together that one interface is missing. You go to the application fact sheet at the interface, hit refresh, you directly have the data quality high and can continue to discuss. This is really a proven methodology to make people see the value of LinaX and help you leverage data quality at the same time. Yeah, so please feel free to try this. I would encourage you to do this. There's some getting started out in Docs, Linux, Net. So if you don't know this, also as a takeaway, we invested quite some time into user documentation. It's docs.linux.net. Feel free to go there. Make sure whether you find your information there. This is important for us that this helps you as a customer. Interface modeling, we had this different use cases and examples. Obviously, there are always cases where you can discuss. Modeling to me, this maybe as a last word here, is never perfect. Modeling means you take some view on the reality and shortcut something. Yeah, so if we come together to the conclusion that the model we presented here is not suitable for your organization, there might be others as well. But remember that one cornerstone of LinaX is that we don't want to talk about model too much. We want to talk about how to get users into the tool and about collaboration and everything. I witness personally that it's often a good idea to take this model, work with it to learn, and then maybe after some time reflect on the shortcomings and make minor tweaks. Yeah. Final step, not sure that anyone went to the talk of Itarecon before about the SAP PI interface? Okay. It's obviously a point where integration comes into play because interface maintenance can be tedious. We have a partner, Itarecon, they have a booth out there who offer an integration with SAP PI or PO, Process Integration and Process Orchestration, where you can directly upload your interfaces from this into LinaX. Yeah, so I can make the introduction afterwards or go to the Itarecon booth if this is interesting. We have other people also experimenting with interfaces to API management, for example. Also, when it comes to the microservice scope, it might be interesting to consider whether you can import APIs directly as well. So this is definitely something to make your life easier in terms of data quality to consider whether it's possible to integrate with some of your systems.